commission to decide first country actions and set the fire and then can be avoided.
Yeah.
It's about not doing harm as well. And also, it's experience I have to the day where I've also changed my medication from 30 milligrams to 15 milligrams. And alongside a blood pressure tablet as well, went along and they prescribed me the wrong stuff. Because I did it in pharmacy, I was able to open the bag and say, these are the wrong things, so that can be put back on the shelf. And that's with online ordering. There was an error within my GP practice in terms of issuing the wrong thing. But because I do that in the practice, they take the labels off and use it again. As I left pharmacy, I couldn't then bring it back. So there's a little bit we have to do about education, checking your meds before you leave the pharmacy, checking lots of new scripts and so on as well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Christina?
I suppose I can say, from my husband's point of view, you've been in the civic medical centre, so you've been doing it a long time.
Yes.
And I can't remember the other system now. So I don't have any problem with the system. But I want to know, though, how does it stop coming? Because how do you know that my husband's taking medication? And if I was somebody who wanted to stockpile, I would say, I've got a month's supply here, so on that day, I'll offer orders and more.
Yeah.
So how would you know? And how do you know if people are misusing it? I mean, you couldn't before, but never before have you said you could, but you suddenly said you'd stockpile again, and I don't see how.
So it can't be 100% about it. When somebody orders this water online, it comes directly to myself as GP. I know, I can see when they've previously ordered it, whether it's the right amount of time, it's a month, or whether it's too far apart, so they're not taking enough, or too close, when there may be a problem with them having. We can't stop people who order at the correct intervals and decide to keep it aside and not use it. But I don't believe that would be common, but you're right, I wouldn't see that. The issue about stockpiling is we know, we have evidence that there were some folk who perhaps themselves or the pharmacist felt they should just order a whole lot and actually weren't taking anything. There is evidence that was happening. So a pile of drugs we know was sitting there, and then if somebody's medical condition may be complex, they have a number of drugs, they could start taking the one that actually I stopped X amount of time ago if it had been carrying on automatically coming each month. So it's not 100%, nothing will be 100%.
Sorry, that's no different than is it from...
No,
you've got the... Still down to the GP to check what it is people are asking for,
yes,
as it was in the past. So if in the past, that's almost like saying that the GP in the past didn't bother to check if people had a pile of different things, which isn't right.
No.
So I still can't see the stockpile. I can see the argument that it makes life easier for people like me because they don't have to go to the door to this past.
Going on every time I come out, they have to close the damn door.
Said that they just acquired, just because possibly ordering like a day or so earlier or something, acquired extra quantities of medication and they were able to use them all. So that's where the sort of stockpiling
is. They'll have to be one tablet.
If you agree, then they'll have to be at the end.
Sorry, how is that going to make 200 British million?
The original amount of stockpiling is if you've got a third party order. They don't know what you've got and what you haven't got. If a patient wants to stop having this, back onto the patient, says the patient will know, I've got 3 loads in the cupboards, I'm going to have to spend this month. The pharmacy order on behalf them won't know that they've got that stockpile, or presuming that everything, and that is the main difference.
Well, sorry, go back to it then. Given that you would be expected to use your inhaler on a regular basis, would assume then that the doctor would be wondering why they've got four stockpiles.
It depends on what can be behaving in the quantity. Yes, there is an element of that, and those checks should be in place with the medication used to go on. Some inhalers will have up to 200 doses, and a patient may use them very, very rarely, and other patients may use up to 8 a day. It depends on the patient, so you need that review and discussion with the patient to assess that. And that is where, if I put you to help the patient to manage their medication, to have those issues will come to light, because the patient is continually requesting medication too frequently.
So the issue is that it's not just inhalers, there's a number of drugs that you take absolutely regularly every day, and there's a number of drugs you take as and when required. I can't tell automatically that every month the ones that are as and when required are actually needed without the patient saying so.
So all they have to do is go ping, 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 ping down all of it. I think it's a good idea, don't get me wrong, but I don't like the argument that it stops stockpiling, and I'd like to know how you know it saved all this money. I'd like to see the figures, because I'm not so
interested. Just to move on, is that something that we could have to look at for the next
time? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Well, we can check.
I would be happy to see that.
Right, moving on, please. We've got Phil next, and then Zazie, please. Thank you, Phil.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm reflecting on Mr. Banks' description of his visit to the chemist, which effectively really brought home the point that our chemists are in a close-knit community, people who know their patients, know what they might be requiring, but that, as Mr. Nussbaum pointed out, if you check down the list and do the medical use review and things that chemists can do, that requires this close liaison with the patient and that personal knowledge. What I was interested in, two things, I think. We discovered that there's a sum of money that is now not being spent or being saved. We had some assurance that some of it, at least, is being ploughed back in. And with the local economy, health service economy, may have certain pressures and may be overspent in some areas rather than others, and they're hoping that the money doesn't plough back into the local health economy. Second, I'm interested in this issue of excluded, as it was called. I know in my local chemist they have a letter from the doctors on the counter with lists of people that might not be caught under the new system, or might be helped through the new system, or might still be helped in the old way. From what's been said by Dr. Wells and others, that because the GPs are independent practices, they might all have their own way of doing things, but is there a standard suggested list of people that should certainly be considered and thought about being kept on the old system so that nobody falls through the net?
There were examples given up as part of the advances going out.
The implementation act that requires services on the but these are the key patients that you want to sit down where they do know they have those potential problems. And that was all done on that bespoke practices that we on the training basis that we did. It is into the GP practices and pharmacies as well, because they need the patients that fall outside of that that we want to and that's where they can't have a footboard. But there's definitely
so, could I ask if, as we're all grateful that pharmacists go the extra mile, is there, can that recommended list, suggested list, be published, sent to us, so we can review it and make sure we understand it?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I think the list is quite important. Some of the key labour from these health watch reports and reaching out to the patients is we need that feedback as well so we can make it as robust as possible, because it is usually only when an incident happens and we investigate it, as you mentioned, the control of drugs, and understand what the barriers and issues are and we can put solutions in. So we can definitely share that if you feel there's going to be some gaps in support that we can look
forward to. Thank you.
Thank you. Leslie?
Thanks, Chair. I mean, the thing with the robust is not a lot of questions for IRL that are actually been asked, but I mean, I'm sorry,
Leslie, excuse me, can we just have one conversation, please? Thank you.
I mean, clearly on the paragraph 4.0 on financial implications, it's quite clear that you can read that as some responsibility and cost avoidance, which clearly has got to be applauded, and also then further on it talks about staff time, and obviously that's been reduced as well, so therefore the staff on the front desk basically have their practices and therefore give people who turn up at the medical centres more time. Particularly, what I'd like to ask really is, I mean, you talk within here when it talks about, I think it's on pages where how people access it, and clearly I think in one of the pie charts there was only 3 people that access via their mobile phone, so I'm assuming that's via my GP app or the patient access app, which if you can get onto it, it's as simple as it could possibly be really. I'm just wondering if you could spell out a little bit about how you can to use that. But also, I was grateful for the comments that Dr. Wells made as well about vulnerable older people and people who are excluded. And it is a bit of a hobby loss of mine, really. But I'd like to see, Chair, if you would agree that when we relook at this again, which I hope we will do, that we have some real solid assurances about particularly older people, not only if they're vulnerable, but older people who are vulnerable and don't have people to advocate on their behalf, really. I do bang on about it, but I think it's something clear because we're keen to, you know, have social care and health joined up, and that's one of our mantras, obviously. But I'm really concerned, only today I've been in a sheltered accommodation in my own ward talking to some residents, and because I knew I was coming here tonight, I did ask. And they were saying, well, it's all right for us because the warden helps us, you know, we can help each other. But so many, and not just in my ward, where there's a predominance of elderly people over 75, but obviously all over the world and beyond, there are those people who, for one reason or other, will fall through the letters as absolutely interested in the So perhaps if we can have some, you know, assurances as to what is happening. And I know you mentioned some of it, but they're the people that are really concerned. You know, and also, like Councillor Johnson said, the difficulty when it's, you know, she has to access drugs with her son. But yeah, just as I say, those people who have nobody to speak up for.
Just regarding the support, I suppose, with the patient access and online. We're going forward, obviously that was a recommendation of Health Watch as well, so we'll be speaking to the patient participation groups and practices to find out the best way to communicate and support the patients, whether it's increased training the staff so they know they can come, or maybe drop-in sessions, maybe like talk to, you know, send it out in a newsletter. There's a variety of ideas that we can possibly do to
I'm just
going to
take one final question, Mike.
Thanks for allowing me. Just think it's worth this committee noting that we've got a bigger problem in this country with addiction to prescribed drugs than we have with an addiction to illegal drugs. So anything we can do to try and rectify that and help the people who are addicted to prescribed drugs has got to be welcomed. And I think this initiative will help. But I do think, Chair, this issue needs to come back to this committee and have a look in 6 months, 12 months.
Great.
Thanks, Chair.
Can I just thank Abigail for a very detailed report, and Dr. Sue Wells and Simon Thomas as well for your input. So if we can note the report, obviously we're going to bring it back in the new municipal year. I mean, we're not sure who will be around this table then, but it will need to be brought back. And in particular, if we can look at the issues around controls, drugs, communications, and as we've a few people have said tonight, vulnerable people are particularly older people. Okay, thank you.
Okay, so moving on to item number 5, phlebotomy, and we've got several votes.
Yes.
Did you want to come to the front, Simon? Or?
No, I've got, it's just a paper open, isn't it? Okay, the paper tells the backstory around the phlebotomy service where in April 2017 members of the Clinical Commissioning Group GP Practices demonstrated an appetite for undertaking more practice-led provision on the phlebotomy service. We undertook some discovery work in terms of member engagement, patient engagement, and a new service design was built, which is set on the top of page 35. We were very clear that the provision would have to offer a combination of appointments and drop-in. Some of those could be in own practice or neighbouring practice. We were also clear that the service also had to cover paediatric care and home visits as well, which is what the previous service did as well, and ensure that the routine referrals were seen within 5 working days of referral, urgent within 2. That there was an 8 till 6 opening time, which allows for results to get allowed quickly, and a maximum wait of 30 minutes. Significant number of member practices indicated they wanted to go to independent in-house provision, work with a federation or work with another provider. So in December of last year, our governing body proposed to go forward with that implementation of that. As it outlines in the bottom of page 3, we have to actually get assurance from each of those practices that they can deliver that service as the budget's been disaggregated to them individually. One of the federations is working alongside the Community Trust, who are the current provider, largely because the Community Trust do have the infrastructure to enable that federation to deliver the services, but also when we embarked upon this, we were actually cognizant of the employees of the Community Trust. The phlebotomists in the Community Trust employees, who are among some of the lowest paid NHS staff on Wirral, and therefore we wanted to make sure they had an opportunity to go into that new service provision. We also need to be clear that the new service providers, whether individual GP practices, consortium GP practices, or GP practices working alongside the Community Trust, are able to deliver the entire service and do so consistently. So there will be monitoring of those contractually to ensure that happens as well. The total annual budget is just shy of £800,000, which would include, I believe, the consumable items for the service as well. And as it says, one federation, as I pointed out, is working in collaboration with the Community Trust, and they've co-designed the delivery model to deliver in partnership, which is something we welcome, as we wish to, as you've heard previously, promote integrated provision as well as integrated commissioning of these services. The services should be up and mobilised by July. We've had the sufficient assurances from the respective providers, and the service should be up again, as I said, 1st of July, the start date.
Thank you, Simon. Do we have any questions? Bruce?
Thank you. Was I called first? I'll give way to Bruce.
You were.
Thank you. Sorry, I thought, come here, Bruce, because you haven't got the last one.
Fine.
No, thanks, Simon. My understanding of this was that it was originally offered in some doctor's surgeries. That was removed from some surgeries because there was an issue over the length of time people waiting to get their blood test back again. It was then put into medical centres and people were having similar problems. Is this an alteration on what was originally proposed in the first place in order to address the issue of people waiting length of time for those results to come through?
So this is before my time, so you may know the history of this too.
So the phlebotomy contract has changed over time. We very much now need to get it right, hence why it's taken a bit of time to try to sort it. In the previous contract, not what we have now, but the previous contract, the community trust supplied for the services of would then be 43 practices, and 10 practices took the contract on themselves. Would have to say one of the differences, though, is about what we're moving to now, is that those 10 practices, I understand, is they did not necessarily undertake the entire service range, which needs to include paediatrics and home visiting, which is a requirement of this the new contract from going, which will have been implemented from July, is that a practice taking that on has to be able to supply either within the practice or by working with their federation or neighbours or with the community trust, the whole breadth of service.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so just to come back to the GP practices that lost this service can now reapply,
yes.
Take it back on again,
yes.
When they felt that they would deliver a good service in the first place.
Yes.
Because there were some petitions, I believe.
Yes.
When this was taken off.
One of the things that we found, though, from the changes we've been through and from the engagement with patients, is that while some patients definitely want to go to a practice or their GP, some would like to be able to just walk into a hub whenever suits them. Okay. So this will supply both.
Thank you, Chair. I want to work out whether there are any gaps. If the GP practices can make arrangements with the neighbouring practice or someone in the Federation, not long ago I think we had a map of Wirral with the new nine areas. The localities. So I'm assuming that they're the localities we're talking about. So have we got maps showing clearly who's doing it, who's not doing it, who's sending somewhere else, so that we know, particularly on transport grounds, that people can actually get to wherever it is? And will there be a way of publicising the ones they can walk into so people can have that element of choice, convenience on the way to work or from it or whatever?
I think that's a really good point, because looking at it, it looks quite, looking at paragraph 5.1, it's quite mosaic, isn't it? There's not the approach, so when we showed you the 1, 4, 9, 4 localities, 9 neighbourhoods, that indicates to me that because we've given it back to GP, there's a little bit of who wants to do it with their friends, as well as actually who wants to do it with, in terms of an integrated way. So it would be good if we could get that map for you, which would be part of the mobilisation, I would presume, and also we need to make sure that any mobilisation providers of those services made sure that their patients were aware of where the services were being offered.
So the commissioning manager who's working with this, unfortunately, is not available today, but my understanding is that has been looked at, what the spread would be, and it will be a requirement to make sure your patients know, your residents know where their options are. Which frankly I have to do at the moment. So if I request a blood test, I give with them a piece of paper that says, these are your options. So I would need to alter what was on that piece of paper.
Okay, with that. Thank you. I just wonder whether it might be worthwhile bringing this back perhaps in September, when we've changed, because we'll have a little bit of time on July. But I'm glad, from a personal point of view, that we seem to be going back to what we were doing before. I went to the lane only last week, probably about 9:30 in the morning, and there was an hour and a half wait. I was told that Easton, there's regularly a 3-hour wait, St. Cat's, an hour and a half. And the staff are actually suffering from verbal abuse as well, from people that aren't happy to wait that length of time. But I think it'd be great if we can see where it's affected.
Do you want to respond to that? Do you mind, Chair?
Yeah, sure.
So those waiting times are unusual, very unusual now. They're generally down to an average of 20 minutes. They only get to those waiting times, and I am alerted to those waiting times when there is something else going on in the system that necessitates that. Some of the patients that you can see when you walk in it. The whole centres are not waiting for the bottom service, they're actually bottom walking service as well. So I do say to receptionists, please make sure patients understand that when they walk in, that that's not, all of these patients aren't waiting for phlebotomy. If there are any members of staff, and I visit these staff regularly myself because I've kept a close eye on the service, experiencing abuse, then I will know about it, and I have been notified recently of that. There was one occasion, but it was quite a while ago, it was receptionist. It was somebody got very angry, understandably. I understand people get angry when they're told it's a weight. But if there is evidence of that and you want to bring that to my attention, please do. I am very grateful to look into that. But just to go back to your original statement, we're not going back. We've actually got a hybrid of the best of both models. And that's what we've done, we've taken the best of both and worked with our colleagues in primary care so that not only patients have access in primary care, should they so wish it, but if they choose to go to a hub, then they have that as well. So hopefully this service will be a significant enhancement and we will monitor it together very closely.
Well, that's good to hear. I will though just come back and say to you that at Mill Lane, I did ask the receptionist, it was a walk-in centre, and she had all these people here waiting for phlebotomy, and she had a lot of people come in because it's a walk-in centre, think everybody's waiting for walk-in, and we'll walk back out. So there was an hour and a half wait. She told me there was an hour and a half wait at St Cats, and she put 19 people in the previous day at Easton at 1 o'clock. So, you know, you might want to check that with your own reception.
I will happily do that. And I think we do need to monitor the activity, even in the new hybrid
service.
We will monitor the activity very, very closely. That it does fluctuate, and we need to understand that. So, you're absolutely right.
Yeah, because I'm getting told that that's quite a regular occurrence. It wasn't right.
Again, don't want to get into a tit for tat, but I do monitor it regularly. If it is starting to peak, we bring it back to our, and we do notify the commissioner right away. But we'll have to monitor.
Thank you. It's not tit for tat. It's scrutiny, and you know that's what I was told.
Yeah. Thank you.
Chair. Yes.
Please, Mike.
This service in the past, and we're getting more and more now. When we go to our GPs, if there's a problem, we have a blood test, so there's more and more need for it.
Yeah. Yeah.
In the past, it has been a nightmare, but my antenna was raised, Sue, when you said, I give my patients a piece of paper with the options on. Well, if I'm in my GP surgery and I need a blood test, I don't want options. I just want that blood test taken as quickly as is humanly possible, and then get the results back, and then we'll see what the problem is. So patients out there are not looking for options. We just want a good service when we need blood to be taken. Thank you. Thanks, Chair.
Absolutely, Councillor Sullivan. We want to be able to provide a good service. What is not possible within a busy practice, as they all are, is to take blood on the person. For the person in front of you at the time, that's not going to happen. In terms of options, I was referring to the fact that the patient survey we did showed that some people want to be able to pre-book at a time that suits their diary and go to a specific place, which may be their practice, communities, and some people want to be able to just walk in to somewhere and have it done at the time of the system. I would agree that as Karen said, looking at waiting list there, but we've tried to be sensitive to the fact that actually not everybody wants the same system.
Okay, thank you. If we could just say then ask people that we'll review that again in around about September, that'd be good. Thank you very much.
My colleague here is a test case because it happened to him yesterday and he's waiting to go very soon. So he can tell us exactly what happened to him.
I'm sure
share that with you.
I'll share the rest of it. I'll do too much detail, Tony, please.
1st of July.
I'll let you know how I go.
Okay, we've now got agenda item 6, the future commissioning strategy for people with disabilities. Jason's going to pick that up.
If people have the opportunity, that's okay. Thank you. Thanks very much, Chair. So this report describes the approach that we will take in the future around the commissioning of health and care support services for people with disability in rural. Predominantly people with learning disability we're talking about in this report. The rural plan sets out a commitment to protecting the most vulnerable, people within rural health and disability. Several strategies underpin these pledges within the plan. The main one that's relevant to this is the all-age disability strategy, which I think is included in the pack for reference. The strategy sets out three key priorities, and these are that all people with disabilities are well and live healthy lives, that young people and adults with disabilities have access to employment and are financially resilient, and that all people with disabilities have choice and control over their lives. So work is underway to bring together a range of resources from the Rural CCG, Clinical Commissioning Group, and the local authority to create a single commissioner for Wirral to address these pledges within the strategies. Working through formal shared arrangements and through a committee in common, this body will ensure that the Council and the CCG can effectively deliver the health and care functions placed upon them in a more joined up way. So it's further integration of the commissioning arrangements. This creates an opportunity for a truly joined up approach to planning and commissioning services for people on the road who have a disability. The creation of an integrated commissioning approach also will enable services to be commissioned through a single body that fulfills the statutory health and care functions of the Council and the CCG. And it will enable strategic outcomes to be effectively delivered through similar planning framework and structure. Future commissioning arrangements will be more effective in increasing the value of the rural pound, undertaking care market shaping and oversight, commissioning a range of provision of high quality, appropriate services which offer choice and control, ensuring continuity of care and preventing market failure, driving partnership working and promoting social inclusion and wellbeing, and delivering an integrated whole system approach to supporting communities. A joint commissioning plan for people with a disability or complex needs is being developed, and that's in order that we have oversight of all the commissioning activity within the rural for this vulnerable group. Commissioning activity that is currently underway and planned for this group includes a range of areas, and they're all listed in the report, and the joint commissioning plan is being developed. It's in draft at the moment and will be finalised over the next few weeks. So commissioning activity that's underway and planned at the moment. We've got a big agenda around extra care housing for people with disabilities. Currently there's no specific extra care housing within Wirral available to people with a learning disability or autism specifically. And we plan to commission a range of extra care housing in line with our strategy over the next 2 to 3 years. New accommodation for such people will include a high standard of accommodation. People will have their own front door, they'll have their own private living space, but they'll have access to communal living space when they need it. And crucially, they'll be on-site support 24/7. We also plan to increase our specific residential care offer for older people with learning disability. We know that we've got an ageing population of people with learning disabilities, and we know that the majority of our people with learning disabilities live in supported living arrangements that are typically smaller houses, 3 to 4 people. What we're seeing is, on occasion, as people get older, their needs are more related to their age rather than specific to their learning disability, and the purpose of them living in supported living is overtaken by their needs due to ageing, and are not able to enjoy the benefits of supported living in the same way. So residential care for people with early disabilities will provide the right kind of environment for people as they move into older age. We've also got some exciting plans, I think, around outcome-based commissioning for supported living. So we will continue to have supported living for people with disabilities, but we think our model of support at the moment doesn't incentivise providers to actually work towards achieving outcomes for people and creating independence for people to whatever degree that is. So we are trialling a model of outcome-based commissioning which will help supported living providers to really focus on the outcomes for individual people and try and achieve a more permanent improvement in their abilities and a reduction in reliance on traditional funded care. This might attract an increased hourly rate for permanent reductions in care. We know that people in many situations have limited opportunity for achieving greater independence, but there are always small areas in people's lives where they can be supported to achieve some greater independence. So that's a model that we're looking at that will incentivise independence building, outcome-based working, and will also help providers to focus on the right areas. Technological solutions for people. We know about assistive technology, and we've typically used that in a lot of settings for older people in sheltered housing, in extra care housing. We haven't maximised the use of assistive technology, we believe, for people with disabilities, and we think that there are naturally increasing offers of technological solutions through the market, developing outside anything we commission. And we want to make sure that we've got good oversight of what's available and what might support people. We know that technological solutions can help people with disabilities, particularly people with learning disabilities, when they're out and about in the community or when they're at home, to access support at the time they need it and to have the assurance that they need, that they can escalate risks. So those are just some of the list of areas that we're currently working on. As we move forward, as I say, we will develop the joint commissioning plan, so we've got complete oversight across what we're commissioning, so that everything's fully joined up and we're very clear that we're delivering our strategic outcomes and working together on that.
Thank you, Jason. I think it's going to be a number of questions. I'll take Anita first, then Christina, Tony, Wendy. Thank you.
Thanks for the presentation, Jason. I'd just like to ask a question. You talked quite a bit about the album, but one of the things that I felt that you didn't touch on much was our young adults with disabilities. So, for instance, if they are at a residential school, they can't stay there during the holiday breaks. And my perception is that it seems to be a very a huge time delay in people getting to know where it is that they're likely to stay whilst the schools are closed down. And I'm just wondering whether you can comment on that, please. As an example, I'm aware of a resident who doesn't currently know what's happened to them at Easter break. Currently in the residential school, so I'll
welcome
comments on that.
Thank you. I'm aware we have improvements to make around transition across the board. Our integrated provider services and adult age disability, part of the rationale for that is to improve transition working. And I think the opportunities here with integrated commissioning will give us better oversight of the people that are coming through children's and young people's services into adulthood, and I think we've got opportunity to better plan for the services that we need. I'm happy to take away any individual cases that you're aware of to look at, because that sounds to me like that's not acceptable for somebody to be so close to their break and not know what the plans are. So I'm happy to personally take that away and find out what the issues are.
Thank you.
Just another question really is, as part of the All Age Disabilities Strategy, People with Disabilities Like Live Independently plan, on page 65, when it talks about short breaks and respite, it's got by when, September 2016. So I would have really thought that there would be some progressive dates there to targets for improvements as we talk about the 2020 pledge. I just wonder if you could comment on that as well.
Yes, certainly. That's kind of time flies, isn't it? So we've already recommissioned respite services and have new providers providing respite care and short breaks for people. So we have some provision provided by Acton Ashbury, by Sanctuary Housing, and we have some provision through Barnston Dale activity based breaks and an increased range of offer for people for respite care needs. We've got some further opportunity to look at the respite care needs and short breaks needs for the future, and this will be detailed in the joint plan, and I will be happy to bring the plan back here once we've got some further detail that's included.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Christina.
Yeah, Jason. First question, very simple. On page 71, I can't see autism together on the steering group members. They seem to be a big part of the life of the people on the spectrum. So I kind of thought they would be there. And then going on from that, on page 42, the extra care housing for people with disabilities. We do have a range of housing for people with autism. So what else have you got planned? The next thing is an observation really. Having been involved in mental health and learning disabilities from the time when it was mental handicap, and gone through people living in hospitals, people going on retraction programs, people living in this sort of house, people living in that sort of house. This is just another of those, isn't it? There's a lot of nice words in it, but a lot of people will say what you want them to say when you ask them what they want, because they don't actually know what all the options are. People never will know. And when you talk about people being independent, I would say that 30% of the population, whether they've got a learning difficulty or not, don't have a lot of independence. They depend on other people, because that's called being part of society and living with other people. And I think you might be taking that away from people, and it just worries me a little bit.
Thank you. In relation to the first part where Autism Together don't have their logo on the strategy, I'm pretty sure that they were involved in feeding into that strategy, but I don't know why the logo's not there or if that was the case, but
I certainly will. So I'm happy to take that to work.
I can give assurance that we are in regular dialogue with Autism Together as a provider in Wirral, and they are very aware of the strategy and are